I do know that from any experience with this kind of treatment, that if someone is subjected to enough physical pain, that person will say whatever is necessary in order to make that pain stop. And that's why there's also a wealth of misinformation that comes out of people who are being subjected to it.
And that's one of the big debates that the torture report has set off. Did it work? Was it worth it? And probably a bigger question for many, was it right? We certainly now know Senator John McCain's stance.
Well, it's been his stance for a long time. He, of course, was a prisoner of war for years in Vietnam. But you now might be surprised who agrees with Senator McCain. Glenn Carl is a former operations officer in the CIA and the author of The Interrogator. Glenn, thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you. My pleasure.
You ran interrogations of a terror detainee 12 years ago. You were there. You saw what happened. There are really two big issues here we're talking about. Do these harsh tactics work, and are they worth it? Let's start with the first question. Based on what you saw and your experience, do they work?
No. There really shouldn't even be a debate about this. The results are clear, have long been known. The FBI has known this. Anyone who's involved in this knows this. And the measures that were used by the CIA and the U.S. military post 9/11 actually were torture techniques that we were subjected to in our training so that we would know what happens to you when you are tortured, not as an interrogation tool to extract useful information. It's just clear. There's no debate. Senator McCain is completely right. He knows firsthand.
Did you think at the time that there would be repercussions when you were in the midst of this? I'm just curious, because I can imagine if you're having a crisis in confidence in what's going on around you, you would be conflicted. How did you respond at the time? I'm curious.
Well, this is part of the tragedy of the whole saga. James Pavitt, who was at the time was senior operations officer. He was the head of the director of operations in the CIA in 2001. And the senior leadership of the CIA and everyone down the ranks was acutely aware that the agency exists to do the jobs that are on the margins of what is acceptable. And when the order came to interrogate these people, he said, and the CIA leaders said, the CIA is always left holding the bag, and we will do nothing that is illegal. We want clear guidance. And the guidance provided was the hack job memorandum that came to be known as the torture memo, written by a political appointee who clearly doesn't understand the substance of the U.S. Constitution and U.S. history, which authorized basically that you can do anything, which contradicts the Constitution, the Eighth Amendment, the Uniform Code of Military Justice, the Convention Against Torture, the Geneva Conventions, and CIA regulations. So it was quite clear, but officers then were in a terrible position because the president had signed an order saying that it was okay from the Department of Justice that contradicted our laws and our oath.
So Glenn, you know, three former directors of the CIA, frankly, the current director of the CIA, they say that these tactics did provide useful information. The president himself refuses to rule out the possibility that they provided useful information. Whether or not it was worth it, that's a different story. What do you say to these people who still think that it can be helpful?
Well, the current president's clearly trying to stay out of a debate from the past, happily. And the directors, some of whom I know personally, are men of integrity, but they are misinformed, actually. I was part of, as were many, many officers, I was not central to this. I was part of these debates ongoing. All of the reports provided from detainees who were subject to enhanced interrogation were recalled at the time as unreliable because, as Senator McCain was just quoted by you saying, information provided under duress cannot be trusted and is frequently wrong. And the 20 cases, the Senate report on this is quite clear, but this was argued vehemently at the time in House. The 20 cases that were touted as triumphs that came from enhanced interrogation, all were shown either not to be cases or the information to be wrong. So our leadership actually was informed incorrectly and I think is sincere in their convictions, but that's not the facts.
enhanced interrogation. It's such a bizarre thing when you actually hear it, you know, sort of talked about. I want to ask you about something that you mentioned, I believe it was on Anderson Cooper's show last night. You say that we can protect ourselves while using methods that align
Absolutely.
With our values. Explain that a little bit more for our viewers now.
Absolutely, absolutely. This Americans need to understand this. This is not about being soft and fuzzy-wuzzy or anything like that. Hard things need to be done. There are people who are trying to kill you or me or destroy our nation and who are antithetical to our way of life. That's a fact. However, the FBI, the U.S. military have long known how to conduct interrogations that are principled and effective and in accordance with our laws and our oaths and our Constitution. It works. We have done so. We continue to do so. We have been very effective, we meaning the U.S. intelligence community and military and FBI, in countering and disrupting and destroying those who seek to harm us, those terrorists who seek to harm us, and doing all of that while upholding our oaths and obeying our laws. Let me point out that the United States, after World War II, prosecuted, convicted, and punished numerous Japanese intelligence officers and soldiers for the war crime of waterboarding. Now, if we found then that it's not okay, that it is a war crime to waterboard, why is it different now? It is not different now. We should not be different people or a different nation, and we can be strong and protect ourselves while upholding who it is we are.
Glenn Carl, thank you so much for joining us at this hour.
Thanks so much. Just ahead for us, in light of this new report, what effect does this now have on the legacy of President George W. Bush? Does it damage that legacy? A whole lot of defenders now coming out. They say it's piling on.